I would like to start with something that is of great current interest right now, and that is the stressed balance sheets of Indian banks and its connection with the financing of infrastructure projects. So I would like to direct this question to Ila. So there's a lot of concern about this, and of course there are many reasons why the banks are stressed, but corruption included. But one of the main reasons, it seems, is the financing of infrastructure projects through this private partnership. So my question to you is this salvageable? And given the difficulties in raising public revenues, public-private partnership arrangements seem like a good way of doing it. And if that fails, then how else should we raise or finance infrastructure projects?
I will not spend too much time on the past, but then again, without talking about a little bit about the past, it's very hard to answer this question. So what was the big difficulty of having infrastructure projects being financed by banks? There was a huge maturity mismatch. Banks take short deposits, and many of the infrastructure projects are like 30 years, maybe less, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, 30 years. And especially when these infrastructure projects got into trouble, because the model we had was that let the developer go and get clearances and so on, and those clearances took time. There were also mistakes made, which were that business was overestimated because it was done in the time of the boom, that a lot of these projects got into trouble. And because a lot of them got into trouble, there were delays, they became NPAs, many attempts were made to try to restructure these loans, thinking that the economy will pick up, that the projects will start behaving properly and yielding revenues, and that didn't happen. So none of the RBI's schemes of allowing banks to restructure these assets, corporate debt restructuring, special debt restructuring, S4A. Now, there's a whole alphabet soup of arrangements that were made. So that really did not yield results, and banks' stressed assets and NPAs became very big. Now, the problem and the question that we need to answer is not just about whether we can recapitalize them and then come back to the same situation maybe a few years later again, but what are the ways out? One of the ways out, if one thinks about it at a more abstract level, is that when you are trying to finance a project that is long-term, then it should be financed by savings that are long-term, rather than trying to finance a long-term project by short-term savings. What are long-term savings? Typically pensions and insurance. Now, if you look at household savings behavior today in India, and that would be true of almost more than 70-80% of households, they don't buy pensions and insurance products other than for that tax, little tax saving that they get to do. The way that tax is structured, it caps the amount of pension and insurance pools that are available in the country. I would like to emphasize that it has to be domestic savings, and it has to be domestic long-term savings that we think about. Because what we are getting is maybe about 2 to 2.5% of GDP, that is capital coming from abroad, which may be, you know, the California Teachers Pension Fund or other, some long-term savings that are coming from there. But domestically, there's very little of that pool happening. So on the one hand, you have to think about how we incentivize long-term savings, pools of savings, which are provident fund, pensions, insurance, while on the other hand, maybe a bond market or other kinds of, whether directly for infrastructure or through financial intermediaries, have a bond market. Some people say that it should be going back to the kind of long-term financing that ICICI kind of banks used to do. But essentially think about financial intermediaries or a market which does long-term investment using long-term funds. Now, what sort of a financial intermediation and reforms for financial intermediation that requires would take a long time to answer. So I'll stop here and maybe we can take it further in the discussion.
I completely agree with Ila, and that requires, I think she stopped short of saying that, but it's clear, and she said this in many of her writings. The corporate bond market, one side is the supply of funds, which would need to come from these long-term savers, which means we need a reform of the EPFO system, the Employee Provident Fund Organization. And in case you need the bond market functioning, you need to go to the root of it all, namely the government bond market. So I think the sort of the deeper problem in the bank balance sheet issue is a whole set of financial sector reform issues, which have been all out on the table, but I think we need to now seriously make progress. Plus also some of the sectoral issues. For instance, in telecom, perhaps we've got some of the, or a bulk of the sectoral issues behind us, but it's not so, for instance, in the municipal sector. If you want to seriously start funding municipal projects in the manner that she described, you have a whole bunch of sectoral issues, for instance, relating to municipal borrowing. That gets you into center, state, local body. So I think the agenda here is truly huge. I'm not going into what happened, but what we need to do is a long list, but as is the case in most issues in India, we know the problems, we know the solutions, we simply need to do them.
I'd like to come in from a different angle. Both Ila and KP have gone into the financing aspect of it. I want to go into the basic assumption behind PPP, which is that, one, of course, government through its budgetary resources doesn't have the money, so you want to tap other sources of funds. But the larger assumption was that private sector efficiency would come into these projects. They would be done better, they would be done at better cost, and so on. So the whole assumption about superior efficiency from the private sector rather than the public works department doing a road. And as it turns out, I mean, there's a simple fact which we need to be aware of, that the average cost of a highway, as assessed by the National Highway Authority, by the time the project came to the banks for funding by whoever got the project cost assessed by the bank was twice the assessment of the NHAI. So between project being given out and project starting to get financed, the cost has doubled. And whether it's doubled because costs have actually doubled, which is unlikely, or because costs have been padded. And the banks have accepted the padded cost. And when costs are padded, the guy handling the project is obviously going to take that money out through downstream expanded padded contracts. So at the end of the day, if the project gets stuck and the bank wants to, you want to reassign the project to somebody else, or you want to get back your loan, you thought you had an asset there which is worth the loan, but the asset is actually only half the value of the loan. So the banks lose. So the root problem, therefore, is the assumption that you can do this with the private sector and make it work. Whereas their motivations are to take the money out at project stage. And I think in a great many cases, this is not the only thing that happened, many other things happened. I think the other issue is that most people handling these infrastructure projects, which are essentially long-term in nature, therefore, trying to assess the risk of that project is difficult. I mean, you can assess a short-term risk, 6 months, 2 years, 1 year. But to say I want to assess a 20-year risk, there are so many more variables involved that assessing this becomes very difficult. So, and then you add in all the project risks of getting your land and, you know, various things that happen. And so too much is being expected of the private party. So if you want to do any kind of PPP, I think it's now obvious that the project risks have to be taken by the government as a sovereign. And it's only the execution risk that should go to the private sector, which is the actual construction work. And beyond that, how do you raise money? You can take completed projects and give them out, bid them out for whoever runs a toll. And once you establish a revenue trend, it becomes an annuity. And then for long-term pension funds, whether here or overseas, can come in quite easily because now the private sector risk is minimized. And then you get the money to do the next set of projects. So instead of looking at PPP as private sector handling most of the project, you have to look at it as private sector handling a smaller part of it and the government doing a better part of it.
I agree, and I just want to add a little to it that even when the padding wasn't done and there were cost delays, there was always this problem that now NHAI had to pay more. The developer would want, the construction company would say, pay me, say, 50% more. And the NHAI, given the CVC, the CBI, the CAG, and all the other fears that every government official lives with, would not say yes to paying more. It would go into appeal and further appeal and further appeal till, and today the situation is that NHAI is one of those agencies that has, 1,17,000, the last I heard, maybe more. So more than one, let's just say more than 1 lakh crores that it owes to the developers. And the developers turn around and say, or the construction companies turn around and say, why should I become an NPA? How do I pay when at the end of the day it is the NHAI that hasn't paid me? So, you know, it's a very, very complex problem. It's not a simple problem. On the other thing, which is that they should be sold off when the road is functioning, just for the toll. So taking the example of toll, that's a model that did start more recently, a couple of years ago. And I believe now 600 kilometers of national highways are under that model. And assuming that the private guy would be able to either, you know, use his influence or bribe somebody to get land acquisition or clearances, it's actually a very bad assumption. You know, to think, let's think 2 minutes about it. What were we saying? We were saying that government can't do it, but the private guy can do it. And the question was not asked, how is it that he's going to get these clearances done if we can't? So I agree that there was a fundamental flaw. There is a fundamental flaw with the model and transferring risk which the sovereign should take to the private. And then at the other end, with trying to, you know, be clean where every official involved will not take decisions. So those were two fundamental flaws that led us to where we are today.
So do other countries use PPP that much, like in other?
Most countries, the public sector runs the infrastructure projects. They don't involve serious private sector.